It's set to be a big one, the FPL family derby, as Spurs take on Liverpool. So let's talk a little bit about some Spurs assets, shall we? Because Son and Kane should be well rested going into this fixture. And of course, Liverpool confirmed that Virgil van Dijk has tested positive for COVID, so they will be without him. Does that mean we should be looking at these two gents?
Well, Liverpool definitely don't look as good defensively if this evening's football's anything to go by, without Van Dijk in the centre of that defence. You know, they were allowing Newcastle to get in between them, and that surely bodes well for any attacking sides that come up against them over the next, well, whilst Van Dijk is out. The issue I have is somewhat that Spurs were actually in good form. Whether Kane was or not is debatable, but as Spurs as a whole, they were on good form. And since Conte arrived, they'd really improved. Has that momentum been a bit lost is my concern, and we won't know that until Sunday afternoon. Mm. It's quite an expensive risk to take to invest in these two when you could maybe invest slightly cheaper in the attacking defenders, maybe. That would probably be where I'd go.
I'm almost waiting for you to retaliate and say, we didn't look bad without Virgil van Dijk, but would you be worried about these two running at Liverpool defence without him?
Yeah, I think you've always got to be worried about these two guys, right? Based on what we saw last season. Maybe not so much this season, of course, but we know what these two guys can do on their day. I agree with Sam. I'm not actually sure we should be labelling it as a rest. I guess you can. But for me, Spurs were looking great under Conte. I think it was, only Liverpool and City better XG in the last four played. So actually, although there's a bit of rhetoric about the fact they've tightened up at the back, actually going forward, pretty good as well. Although Kane not amongst the points, but, you know, Son was and Lucas Moura and others. So actually, they're better at both ends of the pitch. Conte had a really good momentum there. And I wonder whether this kind of mini break because of COVID might just affect that momentum a little bit. But the answer to your question, yeah, of course I'm worried about these guys running at a Virgil van Dijk-less Liverpool defence and possibly no Fabinho as well.
Yeah, indeed. That break that they've had with Conte might even work to Spurs' benefit.
Sure.
He's a manager who's come in midway through the season, had a bit of time finally to work with the team, particularly at the back, where people are expecting big things of the likes of Reguilón, who looked good when he first came in, Conte. Now that he's back from injury, is that somebody you're looking at?
Yeah,
Sam?
Ooh, absolutely.
Yeah,
and I do think so. I think one of the things that Conte has done, as Lee mentioned, is really stabled us at the back. You know, last two Premier League games that we did play, both of them clean sheets, both of them we'd scored, well, two goals and then three goals. So, you know, under Conte so far, seven goals scored, just the one conceded. That's looking really promising for investing in the defence, whether you want to go Reguilón or Ben Davis on the other side.
So if you were somebody who coming into this without Spurs players but looking to invest, you'd actually start at the back rather than the likes of Son and Kane?
I would, yeah. I think, you know, Reguilón at 5.3, Ben Davis, who's in and around the, you know, 4.5 million bracket, both of them are cheapish options. If you've got other players that are out because their games have been suspended, they're easy gets. Whereas to get Kane, to get Son, it is a bit more difficult. You're going to be looking to sell maybe Ronaldo to get Kane, or go Lucas Moura if you want to go for one of the attacking options in the six and a half million bracket.
Right.
You're not bringing in a Spurs defender ahead of Liverpool, though, are you?
That was my next question, because when we look at that Liverpool attack once again tonight,
got a couple of good players in there, Kelly, in that attack.
Is this really going to be the attack to stop this man, Lee?
Yeah, we've got this man, we've got the other guy on the other side.
Yeah, I could list the whole team, really.
Yeah, I mean, and I'm expecting, actually, and Jota owners might not, you might not like me for this, but Jota played quite a lot of that game tonight, and Bobby Firmino is back. Yeah. He's in the team, he's in the squad tonight, I think came on as well. And when Bobby Firmino came off the bench in this evening's game, it wasn't for Jota, it's for Salah. So there's Klopp saying, look, I'm going to protect my key asset, the Egyptian king. I'm going to get as much as I can out of Jota tonight. I don't know, maybe Firmino starts against Spurs. We just saw in the video how good a game he had at the Tottenham Hotspur Stadium last season. Wouldn't surprise me to see him start again, honestly. Sorry, Jota owners.
So, I mean, that's the last thing we need, then, is if Jota doesn't start. I don't know. I mean, I think you protect Firmino and you ease him back in gently. I don't think you give him 90 minutes against Spurs. I think Jota starts and Firmino comes on.
All right.
Let's hope.
It's a very diplomatic answer between the two of us.
I can tell that there's Jota owners speaking as well, isn't it? We're very nervous about getting players out as it is. And what about Andy Robertson then, Lee? Because if you do, there's not many fixtures. If you do want a defender, would you potentially look at Andy Robertson? We do have to be mindful, though, that he's just one booking away from a suspension.
You do have to be mindful of that, yes, although he navigated tonight's game quite well. I think my biggest challenge with getting Robertson in, I don't think he's a bad pick at all in that Liverpool side. And he seems to be, over the last few weeks, passing the eye test for me in terms of going forward. I think he's attacking a little bit more. But look, you're not going to not have Salah. You're not going to not have Trent. And Jota seems like a very obvious third choice pick at the moment in the middle because he's such good value. So unless you're going to magically have four Liverpool spaces, which of course you can't, then you've got to kind of rule out Andy Robertson, I'm afraid. The question mark will be, what do FPL managers do if Salah goes to the African Cup of Nations, which we are expecting? Then that potentially frees up a Liverpool spot if you sell him. And do you spend that money then on Robertson?
My old ma used to say, you can't win fantasy without Man City. She never pronounced it properly, but I think she was right. You know, the principle's correct. When you look at the form they're in, seven straight wins, when you look at what they did to Leeds this midweek, 7-0, and also when you look at the fixtures that Pep side have got coming up, well, you start to think, how many Man City players can we bring in to our teams? There's a little bit of red there in the middle, but I think if you're Pep Guardiola, you think, yeah, not a problem. Chelsea perhaps, Arsenal, well, we'll see. But it's a great run of fixtures, isn't it, Sam? What do you think?
It is a fantastic run of fixtures, and they are getting their star men back at the right time, aren't they, with KDB coming back from injury. I mean, KDB, Mahrez and Foden were the top three for bonus point scores this week in terms of the number of points that they raised to bring them the bonus points. KDB, I thought, had just a phenomenal game. And he is a player that has been so far off of the FPL radars over the course of this season because he's so expensive and we've been trying to get budget enablers so we can have Salah and Ronaldo and everyone else. Right. But my goodness, shouldn't we be taking a little look at KDB now, because he really stood out and he really performed very, very well in game week 17.
That does potentially pose another problem, though, doesn't it, to try and get someone of his price point, 11.8 million at the moment. Is he just a little bit too expensive? Do we need to see a little bit more from him first?
Well, maybe. And maybe we just want to see one or two more performances. I don't think, you know, City aren't going to score seven every week. Well, they could score, the way they're playing, they could score seven every week. But I think Leeds kind of played into their hands a little bit tactically. I think Bielsa got that wrong, but that's a whole other show. But for sure, I think you want Ian on that Manchester City midfield. Right. And you know what this guy's like in terms of FPL points in the past.
Legend.
He's a legend. And he is proper, proper differential. We've not been able to say that too often in the last few seasons.
Although he has had a bout of illness himself. Mm. And he's talked about how he still feels he's recovering from that. So whether Pep feels he's going to be ready to be placed into the kind of starting rotation the way that some of the other midfield assets might be, like Phil Foden, for example, who's way cheaper and has also been performing brilliantly. Goal and an assist in the 7-0 win over Leeds.
Yeah, he's fantastic. I mean, he's the pick for me, I think. Kevin De Bruyne, everything you've just said, James, is right. And he's a little bit more expensive, although some of us might have some Ronaldo money to spend this week. So have a look at maybe the more expensive City mids. But value for money, Foden, I just like the way he plays. And he's so versatile as well for Pep. He can play out left. He can play as false nine. He can play a little bit deeper, although in FPL, we'd prefer him higher up the pitch, of course. For me, he's the one that's likely to get the most minutes, I suggest, for Pep.
Sam, would you agree?
Yeah. I would. I definitely would. I had Foden. The reason for the sigh, I had Foden a few weeks ago. Then, of course, he got that injury. I sold him for Bernardo Silva. That worked very well. Mm. But now I've got the other problem in that Bernardo Silva is now flagged. And now I'm thinking, I really could do with going to Foden. But, of course, I upgraded my goalkeeper with that money. So now I don't have the money to do that. So there's all those kind of problems and there's all of those situations that pan out. And as you've already mentioned, James, you know, the Manchester City midfield is rife for rotation with KDB. We haven't talked about Mahrez or Sterling. Right. There's Gundogan as well. All of those players cannot play at the same time. There's just not enough space in the team. So there will be some rotation because there has to be with that level of quality player. But I do think Foden is the best pick of them all.
You mentioned there that Bernardo only got that one pointer. It was very frustrating, wasn't it, seeing him come off and then Ilkay Gundogan came on and got those two assists. I know you've got him and you said there he is flagged. So is now not the time to buy him if you don't have him?
No, I don't think now's the time to buy him. I will be keeping a very close eye on what Pep says in his last press conference before this game, because he went off, he said it sounded more precautionary than it did a major problem. But I was really frustrated because he probably should have opened the scoring early on from that assist from KDB. And then to see Gundogan come on and do what he did, I was like, oh, that's annoying. But hopefully it's not as bad as first feared, or as I first feared when he disappeared at half-time. And hopefully he'll be all right.
Hopefully. OK. Lee, the other midfield options that Sam was mentioning there, like so Sterling, who was rested midweek against Leeds, who you think probably would start this weekend, although you never know. But also Mahrez and Grealish, who both got on the score sheet. Any of those worth a shout, do you think? Are they in your thoughts at all?
Yeah, well, I don't have any City midfielders right now, so they're absolutely in my thoughts. I was watching that 7-0 very... Well, I was watching it from behind the sofa, let's just say, because every time a goal went in, I thought, that's really hurting my rank, and I need a piece of this. I have to say, having been rested, Sterling is right up there for me. I think he's going to be on penalties as well. And Newcastle have conceded the most amount of penalties so far this season with six.
I'm
looking
at
Sterling, I'm looking at Ronaldo, no fixture at the weekend, and thinking, if I could, it's going to cost me a minus four, but if I could move those funds from Ronaldo to Sterling, is that something that would give me a really nice differential and a way into that Man City midfield? Not exactly the most value for money option. I think Foden's the most value for money, or maybe Grealish, but listen, you know Sterling, fantastic differential.
But Foden's the one you go for.
I think I'd have Foden, yes.
I'm eyeing up Foden as well. What about the back? Because two clean sheets in a row. Would you be tempted by the double up at all in the City defence?
I'm quite happy with just Cancelo. I am, by nature, a bit of a cautious FPL manager, I think, is the best way of describing it. And I really don't like the defensive double up. It worries me for 90 minutes of every game because I think if the clean sheet disappears, I'm very upset. It's not just 4 points, it's eight. So there has to be a really compelling reason for me to double up. Now,
like Newcastle?
Well, like Alonso and Reece James at Chelsea with both a huge attacking potential. At Manchester City, Cancelo, and I don't see somebody else that's got huge attacking potential every single game. You're right, against Newcastle, there's potential for the double clean sheet. That could be a 12 points from the two of them, lovely. But week upon week, how many times are you going to get the clean sheet? Because we haven't been seeing it regularly from any team of late. So I'm quite happy with just the one.
You know, it's a bit of a danger to double up on any team, I think, at the moment. Because if you do, and then a game gets postponed, we have a little bit of uncertainty there. So for me, I'd be spreading your bets, kind of hedging your FPL team a little bit, and just having one defender from each of these teams.
OK, it's time for us to talk about Aston Villa. What a start they have made under Steven Gerrard. Four wins from six under him. So let's take a look at their fixtures to see if that run could continue and see if we can find some FPL points. Because, Lee Bonfield, I am seeing a lot of green in there. That looks good for us managers, doesn't it?
It does look pretty good, yeah. Certainly the next four. I mean, that Chelsea home game sticks out there a little bit, but Chelsea not exactly defensively solid at the moment. Missing, as we mentioned before in the show, Kante, Kovacic and Chilwell and others. So, you know, if you're bringing in an Ollie Watkins or somebody like that... Well, I'm sure we're going to be talking about
him in a second. Who would bring in an Ollie
Watkins, though? Yeah, who would do that?
Who would have had the foresight to bring in an Ollie Watkins? Anyone in the studio bring in Ollie Watkins?
Very good transfer.
I'm just annoyed because now everyone else is going to bring him in as well.
You know what? I have to tell you, everyone else already did bring him in. He was the second most transferred in player
last week.
No, but a lot of wise managers around the world, perhaps you at home did, second most transferred in last week, most transferred in so far this week. And sure, after your seal of approval, that's only going to go up and up. He got two goals as well against Norwich.
He
got a goal and an assist. Two returns. So, bingo. Is that going to continue, do you think?
Yes.
Yes, Sam?
Oh, yes.
I mean,
I think you only have to look back at last season. Ollie Watkins is brilliant. He was a fantastic FPL asset, played really well. I do really like how Aston Villa are playing under Steven Gerrard. It's like a totally different side since game week 12 when he took over. They've been fantastic. Their expected goals have improved. The quality of the defending has improved. And as a result of that, the way that they move forward has improved. Watkins is at the heart of all the good stuff that's happening. Him and Jacob Ramsey in the middle, I think, are fantastic options for us right now.
Yeah, and the price is great as well. What do you think, Lee?
Yeah, he's pretty good, isn't he? I think he's... I mean, they were narrowly beaten by Liverpool, Man City, weren't they? So Steven Gerrard, I agree with Sam, has had a very good start to life at Aston Villa. So at 7.7, he is pretty good value. My concern, and this was my concern back at game week one, was that maybe he'd be shoved out left with Danny Ings in the middle there. And now that Ings is fit, I'm thinking, well, he's going to be Danny Ings in the middle and Watkins is going to be left. And really, we don't want him out there as if you've got him in your FPL team. But apparently not the case. Steven Gerrard seems to want to play Watkins more central. Kind of, I wouldn't say he's building the team around him, but certainly that attacking, let's say the attacking thrust is kind of headed up and spearheaded by Ollie Watkins. So, yeah, it looks a great pick at the minute. It really does.
Brilliant.
And I wasn't the only person in this studio to make an Aston Villa transfer that paid off. And this one might have looked a bit rogue. 4.5 million midfielder Jacob Ramsey, but what a goal for him. 10 points. Three starts in a row for him now, Sam. You must be even happier with him than I am with Ollie Watkins.
Do you know how stressed I was on Tuesday evening trying to decide what to do with Ollie Skip? Because I just had this, like, well, is he going to play? Is he fit? We hadn't had anything from Spurs for ages because, of course, they missed the game week before. And I just thought, I want somebody who is going to play. And Steven Gerrard seems to really like Jacob Ramsey. He, like you say, he's playing him regularly. It's his second goal of the season, so it wasn't unexpected that he scored. His underlying stats were looking promising. And actually, he probably should have had another goal in this game. There were a couple of moments I was watching it where I was like, he could have had 20 points in this game. I really like him. And at 4.5, he's a great enabler. But not only that, he's an enabler that you would happily play. The fixtures we saw earlier, you'd happily play him.
Right,
you don't have to bench him.
Would you say at that price, he's the best midfielder in the game? There's not many 4.5
There's not many at that price, yeah.
That are playing as well.
Yeah, absolutely. First things first, I've got to go on record and say I was so gutted when that goal went in.
I was going to say, I bet watching that with Sam was
painful.
Oh,
she was absolutely over the moon with that goal. It's like Spurs had scored. But Ramsey at 4.5, absolutely. Look, there's not many in that price bracket that are going to get regular game time. And Sam's right, Stevie G seems to like this guy. And why not? He's playing, you know, probably the best football of his Aston Villa career right now. So, yeah, if you for whatever reason you've still got your wild card and you've got to play that over the next few weeks, because of course it's use it or lose it time with the wild card until the end of the year, and then you get the new one again in January. The second wild card comes active in January. You know, why not have a look at Jacob Ramsey? And you're going to be able to free up tons of funds to spend elsewhere on your team.
All right, while you're filling your trolley with Villa players, what about the fullbacks? Cash and Target. Is Cash a good target? Is Target worth your cash? Sam, what do you think?
Both. Yes. Fantastic options.
Which, if you could only afford or only had space for one, which would you go for?
Ooh.
Cash?
I quite like them both, actually. I'd go Target.
Would you go Target? Yeah. Why?
I don't know. I think the underlying stats are actually better for Cash. I just have a feeling about Target. I think he's going to do really well over the next few
weeks.
Well,
we've heard about your Villa feelings. So, yeah. Lee? Yeah.
No, I disagree. I'd go for Matty Cash, simply because I think he's had the most touches in the box of any defender across the season, more than Trent, more than Cancelo, etc. So he's the one that seems to be getting forward into those spaces that we want him in as FPL managers. But listen, both good options, but I would lean towards Cash.
Well, it is a slightly different, trickier game week for us to navigate this weekend. Only 10 teams are in action. So let's focus on some of those teams and the teams that maybe we wouldn't have been targeting players from. Let's start with Leeds and Rafinha. He's been their main man this season, particularly with the injuries to the likes of Patrick Bamford. Maybe, Sam, if managers were going to get rid of him, given the lesser fixtures this week, they'll hold him. Would you advise bringing him in if managers are looking for players who are playing this week? It's Arsenal at home for them.
I mean, I don't think I would buy him, but I equally definitely would not be selling him this weekend. I think, you know, Arsenal, defensively, they've been so promising over the last few weeks. And Ramsdale's been making save after save after save. But Rafinha is one of the best players in the league. And, Leeds have been struggling. They've been struggling lately. They've not been scoring the level of goals, but they've had injuries to big players and the team's had to be shaken up quite a lot. So going into this, I think he will feel confident. He's playing well. Hold him if you've got him, but don't buy him.
Three attacking returns in his last four matches. Mm. Despite what Leeds are doing, and yes, we know he didn't get any returns, as did any of the Leeds team against Manchester City, but do you feel he's a little bit more fixture-proof potentially?
I think he's a little bit more, yeah. Although three of those attacking returns were two penalties, weren't they? And as a Rafinha owner...
But he is on penalties, though. That's the point as well.
He is for now, until the other guys come back. I mean, I think he's third, maybe fourth, but I think third choice penalty taker at Leeds. So the fact I've got two penalty goals out of him in the last few weeks feels a little bit jammy. But listen, I'll take it the way my season's going. So at 6.6, I opened up my app and frankly, he's got a game, so I'm not inclined to sell him. So yes, he will be staying in my team, despite Arsenal away being a tricky fixture, no doubt.
But would you be bringing him in?
I wouldn't be buying him, no.
No,
I wouldn't.
There are only five games this weekend. Are we at the point where we would maybe take a Burnley player because they're in action in game week 18? They've got Villa away. If you would be tempted, is there anybody who would be on your radar?
I must admit, I wouldn't say I'm gagging to get on any Burnley players. They're
all right.
Towards the bottom of the league, aren't they?
I'll give you Charlie Taylor, I think, would be a decent option. I don't think defensively Burnley have been that bad lately. They're nice and cheap, so you can... If you're looking for a Livramento replacement, for example, going to somebody like Loughton or going to Charlie Taylor could give you the playing option that you need and somebody that you're happy to bench over the next few weeks.
Would you be going Chris Wood, though? I think there's better options in that sort of price bracket, isn't there?
Yeah, I'd probably avoid their forward line. They're not scoring enough goals. But defensively...
Yeah.
OK, now let's talk about Newcastle. They have got Manchester City at home, but maybe we could talk about Callum Wilson a little bit because he started on the bench against Liverpool. Do you give him any hope of scoring this fixture, Lee?
Not really, Kelly. No, not
it's
really.
It's all right to say no. It's fine.
Is it OK to say no? OK, no. Listen, Eddie Howe's come in. He's doing a pretty good job at Newcastle and clearly he's playing to his strengths with that team. And the strengths they've got are in attack. I think defensively they leave a little bit to be desired. So, you know, maybe he was looking at that game tonight and thinking, well, listen, we're not thinking we're going to get much from Anfield, so let's save Callum Wilson for the weekend. 7.4, he'll fit, you know, many FPL managers' budgets, but, yeah, I still think there's better options.
It is that time of the programme where we take a look at our guest team. So, Sam, you are up first. You're looking a bit nervy when you're looking at this. Let's have a look then. I'm just going to ask you, what's the plan?
Not to panic. That's the plan.
Keep calm.
Keep calm. Carry on. Make a transfer or maybe two. I'm not keen on taking a -4, I'll be honest. I think that for the majority of FPL managers, we have to remember there's 8 million people all in the same boat here. We've all got the same games cancelled. Yeah. So we're all going to have players not playing. So you don't need to panic. I think I'm just going to do Antonio to Watkins. Mm-hmm. But it does then give me the 0.3 I need to go Bernardo to Foden.
Ooh. Oh, love it.
So at the moment, you've got 9 players. What would you be comfortable with fielding?
10.
So you're not going to try and get to 11?
No.
It's not worth taking a minus?
No, because in order to do that, I'd have to... I mean, I could take Ronaldo out and therefore I could you know, take some money elsewhere and I could get there. But then Bernardo Silva might not play... anyway, so then I'm spending a -4 to get 10, so I might as well just get Foden.
Yeah, makes sense.
Fair enough. All right, Lee, let's see how your team shapes up. First of all, how many players are you going to have as it stands? Ooh, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 9.
Nine.
Same as Sam. Though.
Same as Sam, yeah. I'm not sure
and
why.
And you feel like you want one more player?
I think so. Yeah, I think so. Similarly, I'll be looking at Ronaldo to Watkins. I'll be considering that transfer, but... I can't shake that feeling of how much I was missing out on the Manchester City midfield.
Right. And the other thing is, if you do that, you're going to have about 5-6 million sat in the bank.
Well, that's okay. And I'm comfortable with that.
But can't
I'm comfortable with that.
Can you sit there and not think, oh, I could spend that money on...
Well, I will. That's what I mean, absolutely. I won't be able to just look at that money and think, I'll be thinking about what I can spend it on, James.
Right.
But assuming Ronaldo comes back in for game week 19,
right.
I'm going to want to get him back, I think. So I'm going to be spending that money to get Ronaldo back.
That's
so,
another week. Don't worry about it.
I know, yes. I need this laissez-faire.
We're getting so much insight
James.
Into James as an FPL manager.
I'm ahead of Lee. 2 points ahead of Lee. What a season.
But you also love a transfer, and I know what you're like when you see the money sitting there. Anyway.
Sorry, Lee. That was your segment, and I very rudely...
No, it's fine. Yeah. I think, to be honest with you, same as Sam, I'm just going to, you know, do my transfers at the last minute, keep my eye on the news and see what's happening. But, difficult times in FPL right now, very uncertain times. But for sure, if you've got 9 or 10 players out, probably OK.
Excellent. Time to have a look now at your Twitter questions. @officialFPL is the address to send them to. First one comes from Kevin Prince, who asks, should I go for Watkins as a Ronaldo replacement? Lee.
Well, we discussed it a second ago, didn't we? Yeah, for sure. I mean, Watkins looks like a very nice transfer in this week. And depends what you want to do with that money, James, as well. We had that conversation just before the break. You're going to have 5 or 6 million burning a hole in your pocket. So it gives you the opportunity to do some other stuff as well. So I like it, yes.
All right. Gets the vote from you as well, Sam?
100%, yes.
All right.
OK, the next tweet concerns Rafinha. 3 million in the bank. Who can I replace Rafinha with? Firstly, is this the week to replace Rafinha, do you think, Lee?
Well, as I said before, I've got him. He's got a game, therefore I won't be selling him. But if you do want to replace Rafinha and you've got that money in the bank, then upgrading to a City mid, I think, look no further than that.
OK. A Mutalab is looking to part ways with Tony. Who is his best replacement, Sam?
I mean, this is a difficult one because at 6.6, you can't actually get a lot of players that are playing this week for that money. If you've got a little bit in the bank, you could maybe go to Chris Wood. I think he's 0.1 more. Otherwise, hopefully you've got a bit more in the bank and you can get up to Ollie Watkins because he seems to be the answer to everything in this show. But I do think that he is the best forward to have this week.
This next tweet, I'm going to come to you as well with Sam, because I think this is something we've heard you might be considering. This is coming from Kelvin. Should I transfer Bernardo out for Foden?
Yeah, it's a really tough one, this, because actually, in many ways, I don't want to transfer out Bernardo. I really like owning him. He's been a great option. However, the flag, with five fixtures this week, I can't really have flags in my team. And with Foden playing the way that he is, I do really want Foden. So, yes, probably.
What if he's fine? What if Pep confirms it?
If Pep confirms it, then I can use my transfer doing something else. If Pep says in his press conference Bernardo's going to play, then goodness, don't do it. Do something else.
OK.
All right. An Arsenal question now, or at least partially Arsenal. Ødegaard in for Benrahma. What do you think?
Yeah, I quite like that.
Yes?
Yeah, I quite like that. The West Ham fixtures do improve. They have got a very nice fixture run
coming
up.
They're looking a little bit tired, though,
They are. So it's a form versus fixtures dilemma, but I think I would just sway towards getting Ødegaard, yes.
OK.
It's tighter than it looks, though.
OK, the final tweet also concerns Arsenal. This one has come in from Air Ramsdale, someone who's clearly an Aaron Ramsdale fan, like we all are on this programme as well. Looking at Arsenal's defence, Gabriel or Ben White? Ben White, that little bit more expensive. He's had a price rise this week as well. Which one would you go for, Sam?
I'd still save the money and go with Ben White of these two. I think at that price point, what, 0.7 less? You could do a lot with 0.7 and still bank the Arsenal clean sheets with Ben White. So I'd go with White.
Perfect. What do you think, Lee, actually?
A bit of extra goal threat you get from Gabriel. Certainly noticed that in the last 2 weeks. It's obvious to say, given he scored the other week. But yeah, for a little bit more goal threat, I'd pay a little bit more, but not 0.7. The gap is just a little bit too big.
So Ben White as well.
Ben White for me, yeah.
Time now for us to discuss captaincy. A reminder, only five matches are taking place in this game week. As always, we've picked you some options here. Just the four for you. The man that always features, Mo Salah, Phil Foden, Ollie Watkins or Mason Mount. Thank goodness Mo Salah is playing. Is he still the obvious option? Are you tempted by any of the others, Sam?
Yeah, I'd actually be tempted by all three of the other options this week. I think Salah has got, on paper, the most difficult fixture of them all against Spurs. Spurs side have been defending better. however, I do still think Salah has the potential to score and score well in that game. So I still do think he's the best bet. But these guys could and probably should outscore him this week with the fixtures they have.
Who are you going to actually pick, though, Sam?
I'll end up going Salah because you do.
Of the other three, Lee, who would be the best pick if not Salah?
I do like Foden. I think Man City midfield, Man City as a team, could go a little bit crazy again against Newcastle.
Right. So with him, and I think with any of them, vice-captain's massively important this weekend, though.
It is, yes. And you know, one of the kind of golden rules of FPL is to put your captain and your vice-captain in two separate teams,
right,
particularly with the uncertainty at the moment. So I'll be going Salah captain and I'll be putting my vice-captain on not Jota or Trent, right? It'll be somebody else.
OK. And a vice-captain for you, Sam?
Foden.
But that relies on you bringing Foden in.
Yeah.
Oh,
there you go.
Right, just
so many
decided.
Decisions to make.
Live on air.
Yeah.
Brilliant.